I guess we'll get started. Just wanted to thank everybody, first of all, for coming out. It's not the best night, and when you organize things like this, you never know what kind of crowd you're going to get, and then you get weather like this, and you're really not sure. So I appreciate each and every one of you for taking the time to come out. Thank you so much. We're glad that you could join us tonight for our harm reduction, a family focus panel presentation. It's sure to be a powerful, informative, and important discussion about an approach to drug use that saves lives. Ronnie Power and I were pleased to have the opportunity to organize and host this event, thanks to the generosity of the Canadian Drug Policy Coalition, whose mission is to promote public dialogue on drug policy issues, which include harm reduction. This event is part of a national conversation on Canada's approach to drugs that they are launching this fall. Their director, Donald McPherson, is on our panel tonight, and I will introduce him shortly. Here on PEI, we have harm reduction programs that are saving lives, and we'll hear about some of them tonight. Sadly, though, harm reduction programs and the people who use them can be highly stigmatized. This stigma generally stems from a lack of understanding about what treatment is and how it helps drug users. Our discussion tonight will hopefully leave us all better informed and inspired to support people in our families and in our communities who are struggling with addiction, and to embrace all the paths to recovery that are available to them. If there was only one solution, we wouldn't have an epidemic. To help us get better informed, we have five esteemed panel members who are here to share their knowledge and experience with us. After they have all given their presentations, we will open the floor up for questions, which will be probably in about an hour's time. We will end the night with some closing remarks from our panel members and from me. So before I begin with introductions, I would just ask you that you please turn your phones off before we get started. And thank you for doing that. And so now I'm pleased to introduce our panel members. Donald McPherson is the director of the Canadian Drug Policy Coalition, a national coalition of organizations and individuals working to improve Canada's drug policies. He is the author of Vancouver's groundbreaking Four Pillars Drug Strategy, which called for new approaches to drug problems based on public health principles and appropriate regulation of all psychoactive substances. In 2007, he received the Kaiser Foundation National Award of Excellence in Public Policy in Canada. In 2009, he was awarded the Richard Dennis Drug Peace Award for outstanding achievement in the field of drug policy reform by the Drug Policy Alliance in the United States. He is currently adjunct professor in the Faculty of Health Sciences at Simon Fraser University in Vancouver, Canada. So this is Donald. And Donna May. Donna May, who's beside him, is from Toronto. She's the mother of Jack, a deceased substance user. In her desperate attempts to keep her daughter alive, she was forced to acknowledge just how damaging our broken and outdated health and social welfare systems are. This lived experience, navigating the health, social, and judicial systems in Canada, led to Donna's advocacy work for substance users and their families. By being a voice for the organization Moms United and Mandated to Saving the Lives of Drug Users, Moms Do for short, she advocates for the change in policy and law that are needed in order to actually support a healthy recovery for both the substance user and their loved one. So it's Donna. And Petra Schultz is from Edmonton, and she is the mother of Danny, who died from a fatal dose of fentanyl in April of 2014. Losing her son has made Petra a passionate advocate for people who struggle with mental health and addiction. Together with Donna and three other women, she is a founding member of Moms Do, a coalition of Canadian mothers who have lost sons and daughters to overdose and other drug-related harms. Petra, Donna, and these other mothers openly share the experiences of their children's drug-related deaths across Canada in order to bring awareness to this crisis and effect much-needed change. Thank you, Petra, for being here. And then we have Anne Marie Kerr. She has been a registered nurse for 26 years. She received a diploma from the PEI School of Nursing and her RNBN from the University of New Brunswick. She has worked in pre- and post-surgery units, neonatal, and most recent public health nursing for the past 10 years. She is currently working in Charlottetown's public health nursing on a communicable disease team. As part of this role, she works in the Charlottetown Needle Exchange Program. So thank you, Anne Marie. And then last but not least, we have Tom Adams. He has a Bachelor of Theology and Master in Arts. He is currently working as the Addiction System Navigator at Addiction Services. He has been at Addiction Services for 5 years. This followed a career in private practice counseling. Through his work as a system navigator, he guides clients into appropriate services and conducts group presentations in the transition unit at Mount Herbert. So thank you, Tom. And I just wanted to point out that the session is being taped by Pat Martell, who has volunteered to tape it. Some of you may know Pat from CBC, but he's here on his own time for taping it for us, so we really appreciate that. And then we have Paul in the back doing audio for us, so that was really great. Thank you, Paul Weatherby. I guess in the beginning I probably didn't really introduce myself, but I'm Rose, you might want to know that. I'm Rose Barber, and I'm an addictions advocate and the mother of a young man in recovery, 2 years in recovery, doing well. And then Ronnie Power is over there. She's the other organizer, and she's an addictions advocate as well. So we're happy to have you all here, and we're going to get started now. Maybe we'll start with you, Donald, and we'll kind of work our way down the panel.
Thank you, Donald. Yes, thank you, Rose. Thanks, Rose and Ronnie. It's been great. First of all, I want to say it's great to be on PEI. And I want to say that my family's from PEI. So my dad's from Ewing, my mom's from Marie River, and they both passed away. My dad some time ago, my mom a couple of years ago, and they were great people, and they really didn't do much wrong in life except one thing, which was to move away from PEI before I was born. So when I travel the country, people say, "Well, where are you from?" And I say, "Well, I'm from Ottawa." They say, "Oh, okay. What can we talk about now?" Like, no reaction. No. But then, once in a while, someone like Rose, who might forget that I'm not from here, would introduce me and say, "Oh, this is my friend Donald from PEI. I love PEI." You know? So my cred just, you know, I almost got that PEI cred. You know? Say you're from Ottawa, hell, change the subject. Anyways, it's really exciting to be here. I'm here every summer. We have some property out back of Cardigan, as we say. So I've had meetings with Rose and teleconferences with Ronnie and Rose and trying to support the work that's going on here, but also other parts of the country. The Canadian Drug Policy Coalition is really, it really came out of a UN meeting in 2009 that the UN invited non-governmental organizations to get together and
to think about how the international drug treaties were working. And they sort of opened the Pandora's box by doing that, because when people got together to actually talk about the drug treaties, we said, you know, they're not working very well. Drug prohibition has been in place for 100 years. The treaties have been in place since 61. Drugs are everywhere. People who use drugs are treated like criminals and marginalized and stigmatized and pushed away from services, if anything. So this whole movement that had started before in the 90s, and actually in the early 80s, to really look at how, to acknowledge that drugs are a problem, for sure, and drugs are harmful, but the policies that we surround drugs with are also very harmful, and they've ruined many lives, and made it more difficult for people to with real serious mental health and addictions problem to get help and to be respected and to be included in society. So the coalition came together to really try and encourage whoever is running the country to look for new approaches to then the same old criminalization of people who use drugs, and pretend that we're going to solve this problem through an enforcement and a criminal justice approach. And that is gaining consensus globally, that, you know, this is a health and social issue. It needs to be dealt with through health and social interventions. And there's a big UN meeting coming up next April, the UN's General Assembly Special Session on Drugs, which is the first meeting of the General Assembly on drugs in 20 years. And there's a huge movement to try and, you know, shift the UN's like a pretty, it's worse than our federal government, you know. I mean, it's hard to change. Although we did just change the government, didn't we? Right. I have to keep reminding myself that. I feel like I've been living in a box for the last 10 years. No offense to any Tories in the room. Some of my best friends are Tories. Just tell me to shut up. If I really blow it up here, you know, get into trouble. But anyways, there is an unstoppable shift that's reframing this whole issue to one based on science, public health, social inclusion, and it's so far from the road that governments went down 100 years ago or 50 years ago or in 1972, the war on drugs was declared, that sort of thinking. And it's being led a lot by Latin American countries. Latin American countries are saying, we've had it. We've had it. You guys up north, you like doing drugs, but we are the people who are dying. Hundreds of thousands of Latin Americans in Mexico and Guatemala and Honduras and El Salvador and Colombia have lost their lives, lost their families, lost everything they've had because of the war on drugs in their countries. And many of them are either producing countries or transit countries. They're not drug-using countries. We are the countries that use the drugs. So the whole thing is a train wreck. So it's really exciting to be involved in a movement which is global and local, that is shifting towards a much more reasoned approach to this issue. I'll say a few more words about. I came to work with parents groups when I was in the city in Vancouver, and I didn't know anything about drugs at all. I was a literacy person running a community center, but there was a disaster, drug disaster, going on out in front of the community center at the corner of Main and Hastings in Vancouver, and I got really involved with a bunch of other people to try and figure out what to do. And we learned, we had fresh eyes, we weren't stuck in any box, we learned about other countries' approaches. And we went to Europe and we looked at what the Swiss were doing around harm reduction, which was, you know, 20 years ahead of everyone else. That we looked at what the Dutch were doing. And we came back and tried to influence Vancouver to take a new approach, and with some success. But part of that success was a parents group called From Grief to Action, which was very, very active in those days. They were a self-help group, a support group for parents who had kids or family members with addictions. They were mostly kids. They were mostly young kids, teenagers and early 20s. But, you know, their family members were included too. And they were struggling so much, and they saw this movement in Vancouver to change approaches. And they said, you know, we're a support group, but, you know, getting together and consoling each other every month or every week is good, but we need action. So they changed their name to From Grief to Action, and they became involved in lobbying the city and lobbying the province for services, because they didn't want their kids to die. And they were vigorously advocating for harm reduction programs, including Vancouver's supervised injection site, because they didn't want their kids to die in the downtown east side, because that's where kids went to buy drugs, because drugs are cheaper in the downtown east side. They were fiercely advocating for treatment services, and because there, of course there's never enough treatment or access to treatment, and they were also really critical of services, and they were really critical of bad harm reduction. So, and they were supportive of the, you know, they understood the position of the police trying to enforce laws, but they were critical of the police, and the police would do, you know, silly things like keep addressing, stopping people who were injection drug users and taking their clean syringes away from them, and, you know, stuff like that, or arresting people for a dirty syringe. So that was just, that's what sort of was going on in the early 90s and late 80s in Vancouver. And they advocated for prevention programs, but they were really critical of bad prevention programs, just say no programs, and programs that have no evidence base at all. So they were sort of a model group of people, these parents, who were advocating for a full range of approaches, including some of the most contentious harm reduction approaches, but they were also really critical of approaches that weren't based in evidence. So when they got involved in this issue, the whole issue became not just an issue about drug users down in the downtown east side and some community activists. They basically brought it up to the mayor, city hall level, and said, this isn't a downtown east side issue. This is a Vancouver issue. This is a lower mainland issue. It, you know, it's not about any one population. It can affect every family in the country, and it affects many families in the country. So we really are, I'm really optimistic that we're in, and especially, we're a nonpartisan organization, so we've worked with the Conservative government on overdose issues. We've testified before committees. We did write all the parties around what their approach to five issues in drug policy were: overdose, harm reduction, mandatory minimum sentences, and a couple of other issues. And we got really good responses back from the Greens, the NDP, and the Liberals. And so we're hopeful that the new government, in the new federal government, will begin to take this issue more seriously and really assign the Minister of Health and Minister of Justice perhaps to really pull together a group of people to try and reorient Canada's drug policy. So towards one that's based in evidence and public health and social inclusion. So I'll end there. I'll just say the coalition is made up of about 70 organizations across the country. We meet where we can build on what's already happening. If there's stuff happening in communities, we try and support groups with, you know, very modest sort of financial contributions and showing up with some expertise and bringing some expertise to these meetings. So it's a real pleasure to be here, and I thank you for coming out on a stormy night, and I really look forward to hearing the rest of the panel. So thank you.
Thanks, Donald. You took about half of what I wanted to say away. But that's okay. I've got a lot more. I always do. I want to start out by asking a question of the audience. Have you ever practiced or had practiced on you tough love? And anybody, raise your hands. It's a good number. How many of you believe it works?
Depends on the situation.
Anybody else? I think it does. I don't think it does for everyone. I'm a tough lover. I'm in recovery. And I've been in recovery since January 9th of 2011. I got a telephone call that they were rushing my daughter into surgery, that she had presented with flesh-eating disease, and she was about to have both of her legs amputated. And then it was, what did I just do? I started thinking back to all the opportunities I had to do things differently and started thinking, what would have happened had I have taken those opportunities down a different road, a different path? What could I have done? Should I have done? There was no tough love that was going to get my daughter to stop using intravenous drugs. There wasn't. I criminalized her. I had her put in jail. I had the judge mandate treatment for her upon her release, which didn't even get looked at, didn't even get touched. I removed her three little girls from her care and gave her nothing to live for. I had her brought up on charges of thievery. I stood in front of the judge and called her a prostitute, a pig, an addict. But the one person she wanted to call when she found herself nearly dead, she wouldn't let them take her into surgery until she called and told me, "Mom, I just wanted you to know that no matter what, I love you." So I had a long plane ride across the country to Surrey, BC, frantic that I wasn't going to get there in time, that I wouldn't be able to say goodbye, and I wasn't going to be able to save my daughter. And I got there, and they couldn't do the surgery. It had already spread into the trunk of her body. And she was dying. They gave me a few days to a couple of weeks. But I had a couple of weeks, and I held on to that tight. It was like, I have to know what I did wrong. This is my girl. I didn't raise her to be a drug addict. Jack was in an induced coma, and one of the first things that I asked her when she came out of that was, what do you want to do with the rest of your life? You've only got a few short days. Should I get the kids on a plane so you can say goodbye? Should I bring your family out to the coast? You know, what should we do? And she looked up and she said, I want to teach you what it's like to be an addict. I want you to walk in my shoes and see through my eyes and understand what this is really all about. And thank God I was open to it, because it was nothing that I thought it was. I didn't know that it was not a willful practice, you know, something to do. No, it wasn't. For her, it had begun on a prescription from a doctor for a fall down a flight of stairs onto a concrete basement floor. And she was given OxyContin, but when she used it, she felt normal for the first time in her life. She didn't have anxiety. She could be in social settings. She could function, finally, for the first time. She was a high achiever. She had fabulous marks, but never felt that she fit in. She was uncomfortable in her own skin, and the only thing that helped that was to be high. When the doctor took the OxyContin away from her because she told him, on my advice, that it was helping with her social anxiety, he just stopped it cold. There were no psychiatric treatment, no social treatment, nothing. She was just left to fend for herself. So she stole. She stole drugs in order to keep feeling good. And then that feeling good wasn't enough, and she went on to other things. When OxyContin was made tamper-resistant, it was no longer pleasurable to use it, she turned to heroin. When heroin wasn't available, she turned to fentanyl. She stole fentanyl. She did everything that she could to keep herself feeling normal. Now, having had this experience and having had my daughter now pass for 3.5 years, I've learned an awful lot. I'm doing the one thing that I promised my daughter that I could and I would do, and that's share that experience with those that believe that tough love is the way to go. It is for some. I agree, it is for some. But not for everyone. And we have a full toolbox full of resources that should be used. Because our children aren't cookie cutters. They're all different. You take a look at, if you have 3 children, all of them have different personalities. Some will be addicted, some will be doctors. Some never will get it. Now, it took a lot for me to admit this to myself, never mind to the rest of you. I was a bad mother, that I wouldn't take the time to sit down and take a look at what would have worked for her specifically. I took my love away. Did that work? No. My daughter slept in alleyways. You take a look at the worst pictures of the worst. I've got pictures on my computer you don't want to see. You don't know what smoking crack will do to a person. That was my baby. And she was beautiful. I learned how bad the systems were and how badly they were failing the hard way. Not only did I fail my daughter, our society has failed her, the doctors failed her, the nurses failed her. I advocated for her and got it firsthand, the stigmatization. And it wasn't nice. I had to learn to get a voice, to stand up and say, hey, no, no more. This girl's dying and she deserves respect. And as her mother, I deserve respect too. And I need and I deserve the health care that will keep her alive. 2 weeks, that was the most that they were going to give me for her life, turned out to be 6 months. She walked again. She was in a lot of pain, and she was on a lot of medication, but she walked again, and that was love. That was the toughest love I have ever had to give, to admit that I was wrong. I don't want another mom, another dad, or loved one to have to go through this. All I ask of you is to open your minds. This is a picture of my daughter the day that I brought her home from Surrey, BC to Mississauga, Ontario. She was 98 pounds when I found her in the hospital, and she is 155 here. That's what love does. It gives you back your person, rehumanizes them. This is a picture of Jack. Thank you. A week before she got sick, she was 98 pounds. She was high. She thought she was Wonder Woman. There's hope. But we have to take advantage of the resources that are out there, and we have to advocate for our children through the system, and we have to be a voice. We have to speak up. Too long we've been standing in a closet saying, not my child, or it doesn't affect me, or, you know, I practice tough love so it's not my responsibility. I know that everybody's probably doesn't like me saying that, but we don't bring children into the world to have them die. We bring them into the world to love them through life until we die. No parent should have to bury their children when all these resources are available. In Jack's name, I started advocating at the provincial and the federal levels of government, and I got nowhere. Absolutely nowhere. Doors slammed in my face, people making fun of me, people talking over me. I don't care. Somebody heard me somewhere in some dark corner. Somebody got it. When I heard that the election was called, the first thing I did was find out who was running in my district. And I said, I want a meeting. Because these are the things that matter in my community and a matter amongst my friends, the people that I speak with. And it was a Liberal who stepped forward and accepted the first meeting. And the first question I asked him was, how old are your children? 14, 10, and 9. I said, good luck. Now you've got to help me because I don't want your children to die. And these are the policies that I believe need to be in place in order for that to happen. He listened. He went to Trudeau. He told him, you've got a mad mom out there. I also spoke with the Green Party, and I also spoke with the NDPs. I did speak with the Conservatives earlier, and they refused to have another appointment with me. I'd say that across the board, they're all in favor other than the Conservatives. Now that might change because we're going to have a new pulse or a party leader. I hope. I have a lot of hope. I think we're on the cusp. I think things are turning. I see more and more mums, I say mums, but I mean mums and dads' families, speaking up, admitting it, and knowing that change can be made and help us on the way. Our group Mums Do formed to do a caravan across Canada to bring discussions like this to you all right across the board. My talk is no different here in PEI as it would have been in Yellowknife or Nunavut or Calgary, Edmonton, anywhere. This is my heart. This is what happened to me. This is what I do for my daughter, Jack. I'm taking all the names, the voices, the experiences of all the mums and dads that I speak with who have lost a child or are struggling with their child through their addiction, and I'm sharing that at the UN. I'm only out on the street, but I'm one person representing a numerous population, way too many to discuss. We're going to make a difference because I'm going to make sure we make a difference. Thank you.
Good evening. It's a pleasure being here on your beautiful island. Besides living in Edmonton, we have a home on one of the other beautiful islands on the west coast, in the Gulf Island, and near there in Victoria, we founded Mums Do in August, and we said we want to go coast to coast. I didn't know we would start out with a coast and then fill in the middle as we go along, but it's a pleasure being here and to speak to you. You saw the picture. This is our son, Danny. This picture was taken when Danny graduated from culinary arts in Vancouver, and it was taken about 3 months after he told us he was struggling with opioid addiction. And this picture of Danny was taken in 2012, in the year when he decided he'd start to turn his life around. He died in 2014 at age 25. And one of the messages we got was from people, I didn't know Danny was addicted. He didn't look like an addict. And I said, what do you expect an addict to look like? But people have this image, you know, downtown Vancouver, east side. they don't realize that addiction is something that happens everywhere in society. People don't realize, and something we learned the hard way, that addiction and overdose is something that doesn't discriminate. It happens everywhere. And also what people don't realize, that many people who are struggling with addiction, they still function. And it's that stigma that we have to overcome, and that's why my husband and I, we decided we wanted to speak up. We wanted to tell Danny's story and make sure that people don't feel the shame, don't feel the stigma. I was telling the reporter from The Guardian earlier, I want people to be able to see, sorry, I have to take an afternoon off. I'm seeing my psychiatrist, in the same way as they will say, I have to take the afternoon off. I need to see my cardiologist. It's not a difference, and that's kind of where we need to get. When Danny first told us about his addiction, my husband said, you know, we could lose him to this. And I said, no way. That's absolutely no way. I'm a problem solver. We're going to fix this. We're going to get through this. But as a family, I'm sure many of you have experiences. You struggle through a patchwork of services. Then we were dealing with services both in BC and Alberta. What they have in common is that they are inadequate. What we finally found was working for Danny. Danny agreed to go on a methadone program. But methadone program is a bit misnomer. I understand that here some of the methadone programs also come with counseling. In BC and Alberta, a lot of the programs are just dispensing of the methadone and seeing the doctor once a week. Or it means in Danny's case, at one point he was in counseling for methadone and then went off it, and he couldn't see the counselor anymore because the methadone was gone. So when he really needed the counselor, it wasn't there. Where we went wrong as a family, and you know, when you lose a child, you really ask yourself, what went wrong? What did we do wrong? You ask yourself that every day. And where we went wrong is that we want him off these things. You know, we saw the methadone just like another drug he was on, and I kind of say, so how much longer do you think you need to take that medication of yours? You know, do you think you can lower that dose? And what I have since learned, and research shows, that people have to be on methadone a year or two for it to be really be effective. And some people are on it longer, and some people are on it for the rest of their life. I'd be happy to have them alive on methadone, you know. The other thing we realized with counseling, that the counseling program he was on truly made a difference. But we had to pay for that privately because it was just not readily available for him. As we moved along, had we not pushed him so much to get off things and on with life, it would have maybe given him a better chance, because he too felt that he wanted to be better again, but yet he wasn't strong enough. Has anybody here ever tried to lose weight? And in losing weight, have you just consistently stuck to your diet and never relapsed? You know, it's the same thing when you're trying to get off drugs. It's only that relapse is so much more dangerous. Danny had been in recovery for a year. He had worked in some of the best restaurants in Edmonton. He lived in his own apartment in the downtown. He was doing well, but he had a time when he felt really good, or at times when he felt really bad, he had relapses. His fatal error was not to be in the drug scene anymore. Have I blown the microphone? he was not in the scene anymore. He didn't have the information. What he bought and thought was oxy was instead fentanyl, which is about 20 times stronger than an oxy, 50 times than heroin, and he died of an accidental overdose the night after he had told me that he needed to have another follow-up appointment with his counselor. I knew well enough not to ask him why he wanted the counseling appointment, because I know I wouldn't have gotten the truth. What went wrong? What can we do? And I discovered harm reduction. It's one of the greatest kept secrets, because it's apparent if you seek information
away. There's not enough information about keeping them safe. What can we do to keep them safe? And if there is a message I have to parents is, you know, keep them safe so they can make a better decision on another day. And what these things involve is also educating our children, not just children who struggle with addiction, but really all children should be educated about drugs. And some of us are old enough to remember the discussion about sex ed, you know, how having sex ed was going to lead to wild sex
and lots of unwanted pregnancies and diseases and chaos. Well, what we discovered that sex ed actually does the opposite. It helps gets kids to make smarter choices. And it's the same with drug education. We need to tell our kids not just don't do drugs, because we know teenagers never do anything that we tell them is dangerous. We need to tell them how to be safe. And some of that is one of the things that we advocate with moms too, is to have a conversation. I speak to groups of nursing students at the University of Alberta and at the university where I teach at McEwen, and I don't say, does anybody here do drugs? I say, in case you know anybody or ever come across anybody who encounters drugs, tell them. Tell them to a day they're dangerous, but first and foremost, tell them to never do alone and never do the same thing at the same time. Have a safe observer. Start in small doses. Go on a website and inform yourself what an overdose looks like and what the symptoms are. As a dad who went on the radio in Edmonton just this week, his son's girlfriend had taken fentanyl and was overdosing. This kid had some experience and he recognized an overdose. They got the ambulance in and they gave her an injection of naloxone and the girl came out okay. It's because the kid knew what he was looking for when his girlfriend just said she was really tired. So this is the kind of conversation we have to have towards our kids and the information we have to have out there. And what we need to demand, as Donald said, of governments, we need to demand to change laws so naloxone can be bought at the Shoppers Drug Mart without a prescription. Because it has to be in the hand of people around, not in the hand of people who uses it, that uses drugs. The person who uses drugs can't use it on themselves. And it's literally like an EpiPen for an overdose. And it's proven to be very, very safe, very effective. So we need our new government to make some really quick changes and talk to MPs about that, to take naloxone off formulary, it's called, so it means that we can get it without prescription. What we also need from governments is a 911 amnesty. So when somebody who calls an ambulance is not charged with possession, and ends up in jail. And from there we can move on to actually offer people treatment rather than punishment when they need it. So there are a lot of changes we need to do at a federal legislation level, but on a provincial level, like here in PEI, in Alberta, and in Ontario, and all the other provinces, we have to make sure that the services are available for people. Because sending somebody to detox is not rehab. You know, and not having a program like methadone, having a wait time for methadone after the detox is just an invitation for a relapse. And not having a follow-up program after the program is just an invitation for a relapse. The services have to be integrated and they have to be there for people. As one thing we realized and learned from losing Danny, that for us, we lost a smart young man who played music, who had a wicked sense of humor, who loved his family and friends above all. When he moved out, he decorated his walls with family photos of his grandparents and when they were a young couple, of his brothers when they were babies. Really family-minded kid. His friends miss him terribly. But also, as a society, we have to look at, he was a kid who we paid for school, we paid for post-secondary, we paid for health care, and he was at a point where he was working. He was a taxpayer, where he was contributing to this society, where my husband and I always thought he'd be the one who'd be looking after us when we were old. And all this is gone and taken away. So we have the emotional loss, but also society has a loss. And if we'd spend that money on treatment instead, and invested in people, that would really lead to better outcomes for us, for our whole as a society. At a conference in Edmonton, I learned that in Alberta, in Canada, we spend 95% of our money around drugs on use, reducing the supply, like on crime fighting, and only 5% on reducing demand. Demand reduction by offering treatment and offering alternatives and putting harm reduction measures in place. That's where we need to go. And I hope you can all work towards that, and it's a job for all of us to work towards together and hold our politicians accountable and make sure that our new government in Ottawa keeps those promises they have made to keep our kids safe. Thank you.
So I am a public health nurse. I work in Charlottetown on the communicable disease team. As a public health nurse, our role is health promotion, education. We want to stop the spread of illness. That's our primary role. So as a part of that role, I work in the needle exchange program. So our needle exchange program in Charlottetown and across the island provincially, it's based on a harm reduction model. So a harm reduction model, we strive to really improve physical, mental, spiritual, and social health of the clients. We're very aware that our clients are involved in high-risk activities, but our goal is to really decrease the harm to them. Initially to their families and ultimately the public. A lot of our clients in needle exchange are, we are the only access to healthcare that they're seeing. So it's a really important access for them. The evolution of our program on PEI, in 2009 a partnership began between the PEI Chief Public Health Office and Public Health Nursing and Primary Care Health PEI. In 2010 there was a working group struck that ensured services and standardized policies and standardization across the province. So presently, across the province, we have four access sites. We have Needle Exchange in Charlottetown, Summerside, Montague, and West Prince. Goals for our needle exchange, many goals, but primarily to prevent the transmission of viruses that cause HIV, Hep B, and Hep C. And of course, this happens when people are sharing equipment, sharing needles. Provide intravenous drug users with clean needles, safe equipment, referrals to service providers, immunizations, education to support optimal health. We really want to ensure the safe disposal of used needles and equipment, and we really encourage this. When clients pick up needles, we give them Sharps containers of all different sizes so they can bring the needles back to us so we can dispose of them safely. And importantly, we provide a confidential, non-judgmental service. We really want to empower our clients to make good health decisions for themselves. And it's not always the big steps. It's very little steps. A client brings back some needles and we're thrilled. You know, we thank them, explain why it's so important, and that makes them feel good. So perhaps they're empowered to make more good choices for themselves. They might decide that vaccines are a good idea, so they'll make that decision. They'll want some education from us. So it's very small steps, but very significant steps. So some quick facts. PEI has had over 425 cases of hepatitis C diagnosed between 2000 and 2010. Most of all of these cases are due to sharing equipment during IV drug use. Visitation at needle exchange sites has increased since 2009. In 2014, we had over 1,000 visits to sites across the island. Numbers of needles provided and returned have increased. In 2010, we distributed 34,000 needles across the island. And in 2014, we distributed over 157,000. And most of those are coming back to us for safe disposal. So really important numbers. Profile of a needle exchange client. They're almost half and half male, female. Age can range from 18 up to 60. And when asked how they heard about it, it's usually word of mouth. They heard on the street from a friend about the program. So that's what brings them in. Equipment and services provided, of course, syringes and needles, sharps containers, alcohol swabs, tourniquets, filters, cookers. We supply condoms, sexual health teaching with that if they're wanting to hear that. Antibiotic ointment. We supply healthy drinks. It's available to clients when they come in. A really important part of our program is immunizations. So as they come into us, we have the immunizations right there, and then they want the flu vaccine, hepatitis A, hepatitis B, pneumonia vaccine, diphtheria, tetanus, whooping cough. They have access through us for those vaccines. And it's really, that has gone very well. I've had the last few months, clients are asking, you know, do you have the flu vaccine yet? So it's wonderful that they're taking us up on these services. We do vein assessments, educate for safer injection sites to decrease infection, and we do some minor wound care. We also do lots of education on other topics and referrals as appropriate. So successes, you know, we've had many in our needle exchange. We're able to provide continuity of care. We have the ability to establish relationships. We have good rapport with the clients. We usually see the clients on average every 2 to 4 weeks. We'll see the client. And it's a very small group of nurses in the needle exchange, so we can really establish those relationships. Clients are very open to discussing their challenges, their health needs, and ask us questions on anything and everything. And we're there to listen to them. Provision of counseling and referrals. Vaccine uptake has been good. Needle return rates are increasing and participation rates are increasing. So challenges, of course, hepatitis C rates are on the rise. Intravenous drug use is on the rise. We did do a needs assessment with our clients this year just to kind of see how we were doing, if we could do anything differently. And a common theme was our hours. They wanted to see us there in the evenings, weekends, when it's a little bit easier for them to access. So we're working on that. So that's a good thing. I'll finish up I just wanted to share just some anonymous comments from some of our clients, and we call it the voice of our clients. So one young man, he said, none of us want to be like this. That was his comment. A young girl, I don't know what I would do if you weren't here. My money would go to the pills first. Another young man, you don't judge me. That was very important to him. And finally, a young man said, I've been doing everything wrong in my life, but being here, perhaps I'm doing something right. So that's everything. I do have some posters, and feel free to take them if you have somewhere to put them up to spread the word about needle exchange, and ask questions.
Thank you. I had the opportunity of spending a couple of hours at the needle exchange last year in Summerside, and it was an eye-opening experience. I appreciate the work that you do. My name is Tom Adams. I'm with Health PEI. I work in addiction services. I'm the addiction system navigator, and I also work on the transition unit, leading some groups and doing some casework. I'm thankful for being here tonight, being asked to be on this panel to talk about this very important topic, harm reduction. I just want to start with maybe a working definition of what harm reduction is for healthcare. It would be any program or policy that's designed to reduce drug-related harm without requiring the cessation of drug use. I'll say that again. It's any program or policy that's designed to reduce drug-related harm without requiring the cessation of drug use. So harm reduction is not necessarily incompatible with the idea of abstinence, but it doesn't require it. An individual reducing use, limiting the kinds of substances that he's using, engaging in safer drug-related practices today, may indeed one day decide to stop using all addictive substances, or may not. But harm reduction is about working with people where they're at, rather than requiring them to be where we're at in order to work with them. It's about taking the steps that can be taken in the here and now to make things better in the client's lives, regardless of any commitment or lack thereof to complete abstinence. In addictions treatment or addictions helping environments, whether they're through health services or whether they're community-based, the two most common philosophies would be abstinence, and that's stopping everything that you're using or doing, and the other is harm reduction, and that's reducing or stopping some substances or substance-related practices that will likely result in less harm happening, both to the client, him or herself, and often society as a whole. But that without necessarily stopping everything. If we're talking about harm reduction, if we could for a minute, well, let's talk about some common areas where harm happens related to drug use. First of all, there's physical harm, many different types of physical harm. Poor nutrition, the toll that an addict's body goes through with repeated withdrawals, damaged veins, hepatitis C, HIV, AIDS, other life-threatening infections, and of course there's the damage to the body associated with overdose. And of course, as you've heard tonight, some of these physical harms are life-ending. Then there are the harms related to the dangerous drug-seeking behaviors. Sometimes when people are desperate, they'll commit break and enters, they'll do armed robberies. Sometimes the only thing that they have to do their armed robbery with is a dirty needle. People sell their bodies. Think of the threat to one's personal safety when desperation forces them to go somewhere out of the way with the kind of person who has no problem with taking advantage of their desperation. There are the harms on one's quality of life, social, financial, family relationships, often harmed, often ended, criminal justice consequences. People go into jail for either crimes that they've committed to get drugs or the things that they've done while under the influence. Exploitation happens in various ways and often when people are addicted. I remember talking with an individual who sold his car for 5 pills. Inadequate employment, inadequate housing. The harms experienced by both the addict and society around them are huge. So I want to talk for just a minute about the value of harm reduction in addiction treatment. And it needs to be said, or it shouldn't need to be said, I would think, and yet because people can often be ideologically driven rather than pragmatically driven, it needs to be said that if someone is addicted to hard drugs like opiates, for instance, and this person is racked with pain from withdrawal on a regular basis, to the point that she's using dirty needles when there aren't any clean ones available. She's been robbing her parents and her siblings. She's alienated all of her supports. She's lost her job. She's lost her home. She's selling her body for a fix. She's even engaging in robberies. It hardly needs to be said that a harm reduction approach using Suboxone or methadone, even if she does continue smoking weed or munching on the occasional mushroom, is far preferable to leaving her there. Or if a man has a serious problem with alcohol, he gets drunk often, and when he does, people get hurt, his wife, his kids. And the kind of stuff that he does when he's drunk lands him in jail. But this same man, once or twice a month, gets together with the boys. They watch the game, whatever is in season, football, hockey. They smoke a bag of weed and they order some pizza. Now think about it. He wants help with his problematic drinking. But to get together with his friends, which results in no greater harm than $20 going to Pizza Hut or Domino's, it's not something that he wants to or is willing to give up. Again, think about it. Abstinence says, we can't help you unless you give it all up, whereas harm reduction says, come on in. We'll help you with that alcohol problem that's been giving you so much grief. Probably also a warning of the possibility of cross-addiction and that one substance might eventually be substituted for the other. But it meets him where it's at and it helps him with what he wants help with. Historically, I could say addiction services has taken mostly an idealistic approach, requiring abstinence. That's the way it had been for a long time. The reality was, though, that there were a lot of people whose needs weren't being met. And that all-or-nothing approach was leaving lots of people without the help that they wanted, because the help that they wanted was always packaged together with help that wasn't wanted. We had a big shift in philosophy, or at least it began to be a big shift with the Provincial Methadone Maintenance Treatment Program when it first opened at Mount Herbert back in 2004. There are now 220 clients in that clinic's harm reduction program. And then this was followed by a 12-week-long post-induction support group for methadone maintenance treatment program clients in Summerside in 2010, which then expanded further by the opening of a second methadone treatment program clinic in Summerside, and that was in October of 2013. And that clinic now has 167 clients in it, for a total of close to 390 health PEI methadone maintenance treatment program clients. And while it's not part of addiction services, we're also delighted at the opening of the Queen Street Methadone Clinic in Charlottetown last year. But harm reduction reaches beyond opiate addiction and methadone maintenance treatment. At Health PEI, we want to meet our clients where they're at and help them with their addictive struggles. And for that reason, every addictions counselor in the province has been trained in motivational interviewing. That's a counseling approach that starts with people where they're at and builds a person-centered treatment plan around the client's own goals. And while clients who show up at the inpatient withdrawal management won't be allowed to use illicit substances, obviously, while they're there, the nursing staff will help them detox from their chosen substances, even if they choose not to give up all others. What it comes down to is improving health, reducing damage, and in many cases, saving lives. When I started working with addictions a little over a half decade ago, one of my first roles was facilitating that 12-week post-induction support group for methadone maintenance treatment program clients in Summerside that I just mentioned. That was, hands down, the most rewarding part of my work, even though, in many cases, my clients were still using one substance or another. And I'll just wrap up by telling you why it was so rewarding. I saw what active addiction was doing to people before they were receiving treatment, and then I saw the same people after beginning treatment. And in only the 12 weeks that I worked with these clients, the changes that I saw were nothing short of inspiring, and it was often exciting. People who had been committing crimes were stopping. People who were being exploited were being freed from that. People who were selling their bodies were freed from the need to do so. People who were destroying their health were regaining their weight and their color. People who had no hope of employment were getting back to work. People whose arms had looked like pincushions were healing over. People who had been alienated from their families were being reconciled. I think that was probably my greatest joy in doing that support group, was seeing families reunited and reconciled. and people. People who had given up hope in life were choosing once again to live. Thanks.
Well, thank you to all of our panelists. You were wonderful. You all spoke about very important things, and I learned a lot as well about some things that we're doing here that I didn't necessarily know. So, great. Thank you all so much. And this is the part in the evening where we're going to open the floor to any questions that anybody has. And Ronnie is going to grab a microphone, and she's going to, if you have a question, raise your hand, and for any of the panelists, and she'll bring that to you.
My question, and thank you all, by the way, it was great, but my question in particular pertains to Mount Herbert facility. Meeting people throughout meetings and whatnot, you hear a lot of their different stories, and one particular individual was able to go into detox and, you know, did the process, and his next move was transition. However, at that time, there wasn't any beds available for him. So he'd already went through the process of his detoxing and then was sent back out until there was room for transition. And so I guess my question is like, with harm reduction in there, is that not kind of, is there other ways that we can, is there a safe, I don't know, a safer, more environment for a waiting period?
One of the things that I could say with respect to that is that we're planning a change in the near future where the hall that is between detox and transition unit, which holds another, I think it's 6 or 8 beds, will be flex beds that can be used by the transition unit. So a number of clients have had the same experience that you're talking about, where they've been detoxed, they've wanted the transition unit, and too many people have wanted it at the same time, and there haven't been beds available. Yeah. So we're working on a plan to open up that hall in between so that more people can take the TU program.
That's fantastic. Thanks.
Could I also address that?
Yeah.
Thank you. There are facilities, there's one facility out on the West Coast in particular called Insight, and they do everything towards harm reduction. Insight is a safe injection site or a supervised consumption site. What they do there when people are ready to give up their drugs and you know, they're sick, they're tired of it, they walk them right into detox. And it's upstairs. So there's no waiting, there's no challenge with getting a place or anything like that. Once they've gone through detox, they have another section of their building that they house them in until they can get into a rehab facility. So it's all supported, it's supervised, but it's not mandated. You can still come and go as you like if you decide to, but if you go, you have to go through the process again, so the detoxing again and things like that. I've been in contact with people who have been looking at putting these facilities right across Canada. My daughter died a horrible death, and I would have liked to have had something like that available for her. So one of my mandates to myself is to make sure that these are facilitated. With the plan that some of our CHCs are doing is to integrate them into the healthcare system. So an already existing needle exchange, that type of thing, like what you're doing. But they're working on the same model as the one that is out on the West Coast. And we hope, we think, because it statistically proven to work, that it will be based on the model in the West, but improved.
What's your name?
I'm sorry?
What's the name?
Insight.
Any other questions?
Hi, My question is for Tom Adams. My son struggles with drug abuse and addiction, and he's currently at the Summerside Youth Center. Since he had a drug counselor based in Charlottetown, he's not eligible to receive counseling while he's in Summerside, other than a biweekly phone call. So I'm just wondering if there's any other services he can get while he's there, or if there's any changes going to happen in that area.
Well, I'm not sure about how frequently he would be meeting with this Charlottetown-based addictions counselor, but there's a very good staff at the Strength Program, and because it's youth-based, there are probably more people there, more services there than there are.
He's not in Strength. He's in the criminal youth center. So he's been charged, and he's sentenced to 3 months in the youth center on a criminal charge. So he's not in the Strength Program.
Okay, my apologies. The Strength Program's in the same building. I was confused.
Yep.
I wonder if his file could be transferred to one of the youth counselors up in Summerside. Cindy Galt or Danny Creelman are both youth counselors out of Summerside, and they're a stone's throw away.
Well, that was brought up, but they said that since he already has a rapport with the counselor in Charlottetown, that that's not an option. So I was just wondering if it would really be that big of an issue to, while he's there, to have some counseling. I know he has a good rapport with his counselor in Charlottetown, but would it really be that much of a step backwards to start a new rapport with someone else?
Well, I'm not sure if it would be or not. If you speak to me afterward, I can talk to the people who would make those decisions directly.
Okay, thank you.
For sharing your son's case. What this illustrates for me is that what is needed is that people who need treatment should not be in jail. And that and while we demand things from our government, and we have to look at decriminalizing possession, and our friends, we closely work with a group in the UK called Anyone's Child, and they put out some really good educational materials, and there's a little video that explains the difference between legalization and decriminalization, because a lot of people get that mixed up. So when you talk to people out there, say, when we say decriminalize possession and give our kids treatment instead of jail time, we don't mean legalizing everything. That is a different discussion that might also be something we want to look at, but it's a different discussion. Decriminalizing means it's still against the law, but we don't throw them in jail. We put them in touch with people like you and make sure they get treatment. And your case totally breaks my heart to hear you talk.
Can I add as well? I've spent the last several weeks with a young couple who got themselves into trouble. She was working in a pharmacy, and he was abusing substances, and she got involved in using as well. So they stole from the pharmacy, and then they immediately regretted it. And what do you do? So my advice was, turn yourself in, but first, seek counseling. Get a plan together. Get yourself a good counselor. Get yourself a good lawyer. And have a plan going into treatment. Not to present to the judge. Well, they didn't have the opportunity because I couldn't be right there with them advocating them through the system. But I knew what to do. And I knew what to tell them to do. They just didn't have the, I'm going to say wherewithal, if everybody understands. When you're that mixed up and anxious about what's going to happen with your life, it's very difficult to carry through. No parents around, nobody, no support. I did the best I could, but today he had had enough. He ran out of the house, left a suicide note behind, and we were all afraid that we were going to get the phone call that he had taken his life. He's tired. He's tired of living. He's tired of living on the run. He's tired of living on drugs. Best case scenario was that we were able to get him arrested before he was able to commit suicide. Now, is this? Seriously. You know, why could I not get him into a treatment facility? Why could I not get him a lawyer, you know, that would take the case? This is just ridiculous. Like, we are killing people, and we can't let this go on. And I'm sorry to say that the best case scenario is that they're both incarcerated right now, scared shitless, scared out of their wits. And we're talking 21 years old, both of them. Their lives are gone. We did it. Our policies did it.
I just have a couple of thoughts, and thanks everybody for speaking tonight. I work around addictions. I don't know if you would classify me as a frontline worker, but I believe I am. I was the crack addict that was on the downtown east side. I was in that alley. I know that place. You know, so when I hear somebody say, you don't know where I've been, I don't know. I think I do. You know, I don't know a mom that's lost a child. But I've lost a lot of friends, and I know that place. I struggle. I struggle with a lot of stuff I hear. I think why I struggle is I'm an addict. You know, I was there. I know what the hell. And for me, my belief system got me. I took my people around here. I took my first drink at Simmons Sports Center outside. My last one was in a room in Maine and Hastings with a crack pipe in my hand. And what I know today is my belief system took me there. I believe something. I believe I wasn't worthy. And I've been around this for a while, and from the West Coast and now back in the East Coast. And this isn't to offend or anything. This is just what I believe. This is just my thoughts. And I hear a lot of wonderful things here. Policy, government, how we can change things. I believe we're missing the point. Long before, I believe people I deal with, I've been around, and 99.9 tell me the same thing. I come from trauma. Mentally, physically, sexually. Yeah. That's where I come from. Nobody's fault. This isn't about blame, so please don't be offended by what I'm... But this is my reality. Yeah. And so I think the point we're missing is we hear government isn't doing this, communities aren't doing this, this and that, but what am I who's raising this, what am I doing? And this isn't about blame. Please don't take me wrong, because I understand why certain things are. I work a lot in the Aboriginal community, and it's devastating. It's beyond, it makes me cry, it's beyond devastating. And so I think, you know, we need, everything you guys say, I truly believe, we need that. But I think the point we're missing a lot of times is, by the time we see this, we're at a stage of acute. We're at a terminal stage, and then we're just 50-50. Are we going to make it or are we not? God bless your daughter, she didn't. I did, you know what I mean? It could have been me, it might not have been your daughter. I don't know why that is. That's whatever, God's will or whatever. But I think to prevention, why is it that I picked up a drug? And what I've learned is there's a reason why there, and there's a belief system there. I call it shame, that's my belief. You know, guilt is we made a mistake, shame is I am a mistake. And I've been around a lot of people with addiction issues, and there's one word I hear of, I never liked myself. Something told me that. And again, this isn't about blame, this is reality.
I didn't tell that lightly when I said my daughter's social anxiety event. And I agree with you. There was trauma and drama in her life that was never looked at, ever.
Yeah. So It's not that I'm against harm reduction, but I think, and I see this in Prince Edward Island different than British Columbia, since I lived 20 years out there, so I saw some progression of, and I, you know, and I believe it's coming east, and hopefully we'll get here, but I believe we have to focus more on what this person needs inside. How can we change that belief system? God bless methadone maintenance. I understand that. I understand there's a part that maybe needs that. But I think what we're forgetting is why this person got to that place in the first place. Not what he needs right now to keep him, you know. Because this is just me again. I have a lot of people around me that are on methadone, but they're still using and they're still struggling. That's my reality. I'm not saying it's not working, but that's my reality. And the gentleman, the mom in the middle who said, I wish my son had more counseling than that. I think that's what we're kind of missing. We're missing, how can we work with the client or patient, as I call them, more on a one-on-one and a lot more on a peer-to-peer basis? I think there's another big key we're missing around a lot of these is, well, you go see your counselor once a week, where maybe it's more about somebody beside me who's been through the same thing and say, you know what, I've been there, how can I help you? And I think we're missing a lot of that. We're putting the blame on the government, we're putting the blame on the justice system. Well, what can we do so we don't get to that point? What can we do so we don't get to prisons? What can we do so we don't get to treatment centers? What can we do so we don't, the kids are still in school? And I saw a beautiful thing not too long ago in Nova Scotia, I think they're doing it, where a child in grade one, when he walks in, the first thing they do, they don't do math or English, is how are you feeling today? And I thought that was the most brilliant thing I've ever heard. Because for me, I didn't know how to feel. I didn't ever understand what a feeling was. Today I get that. And today I get the reasons why. And today I get that person who I didn't like, he was just a sick person too, he wasn't a bad person. I get that today. So for me, I think everything you say is well, but I think we have to put a lot more in, how can I help this child so at 16 he isn't doing a crack pipe in downtown Maine and Hastings? Thank you.
What I'd like to touch on as well, brought up very good points as well as some memories and regarding trauma. I'm a recovering addict, 22 years. I have three sons. One passed away 11 years ago. One is in recovery, thank the Lord. And the other one is utilizing the Suboxone. I think that his trauma, I see where his trauma started at an early age. It was at the end of my addiction. And he had various head injuries as a child, which I think were part and parcel of where he's at today. I also think the fact that I drank alcohol while I was pregnant may have had something to do with it, although he's never been, he has been tested and hasn't been shown to have fetal alcohol effects or syndrome. I always stuck up for him. Okay, this is my son that's on Suboxone. So I think that what I've seen over the past 22 years of his heroin addiction and now his maintenance program, he has a good life today. It's not, he does live in the downtown east side. He does have an accommodation. He does have a health center. He does have friends. I don't think he is 100% happy, but compared to 10 years ago, before he started on with the methadone, there were the suicide attempts, and there were the, you know, the overdoses, and the Narcans, and the, is he gonna make it, and the torn open arms, and the sores, and the, you know, he's living a life. He has a quality of life today. It might not be what I would want him to have, or what other people think is what he should have, but it's working. He's still got a sense of humor. He's doing the best he can along with mental illness that he has. And he has, he's been through the whole insight, on-site, waiting, treatment. I think a key that was brought up by the gentleman that spoke before me is long-term treatment. 28 days does not do it. No gaps. Straight from detox to treatment, to stabilization till treatment. If they need medical care, please let them come into the hospital. My son has sat for hours, days, waiting, feeling a psychosis coming on, wanting the help, but now known as an addict, and most often told to leave. And this is in Vancouver. What we have in, I'm from Nova Scotia. My name is Barb McKay, in case anyone wants to know. we have nothing. We have nothing. We have two detoxes. So, in and out of detox, they go. And there's nowhere. There's not a women, there's not a halfway house, there's not a shelter, there's nowhere for the men to go. There's no, you know, we have the homeless shelter. It just started this year. We have the food bank. Very minimal, minimal. We have a new, I believe, a mental health and addictions have joined together now, and I'm hoping that there won't be so many gaps between what's required, what's needed, what's urgent. I'm really excited to be here, and I'm most impressed by all the presentations and the people. And I really thank everyone for being here, and I'm just over the moon that I've had the opportunity to come here and hear all this. So thank you.
Say, I was first off, the ladies who shared their stories, I was very touched by that, and I too am in recovery and received a lot of treatment here in Prince Edward Island. And I will say, I am quite thrown back, because even with them 7 years ago, people weren't talking the way that you guys are talking now. So, as far as we may think we haven't moved ahead, as far as the shame part, I'm blown away if this conversation was probably where I was. I did encounter, or I felt, you know, ashamed to go get help. It's hard for me to talk about it here. I live in a small community. There's still, it's the biggest accomplishment of my life, but yet I feel ashamed of it to this day, to a point, only because the fear is always there about a job or whatever. But to the point where I'm sitting here, I'm thinking, wow, like, there's some really good conversation that's happening. The needle exchange, you have to understand from their perspective, to talk to someone who gives you dignity. Like, I kept hearing it through everybody. They're open. They want to talk. It's because we want to be heard. We want the help. You want to be met where you're at. You're a human being. like everyone else. And when someone gives you that, regardless if it's abstinence that very day, you've opened the door for an opportunity for someone to get help. You did a wonderful job. I always have said, if I think if families could only understand when the person is at the end of their active addiction, where it's not about, I'm having a party and I'm getting high, it's really survival. And for you to articulate what your daughter was going through, because at that point, I mean, it's the shame that is driving you to continue your use. I just couldn't be quiet. I had to just say, I mean, I know there's a lot that needs to be done in the services. I think what I hear is more, it's, you know, peer-to-peer, or more people just need to be heard. And you'd be surprised what talking does. I've talked myself out of a lot of relapses, a lot of cravings. People's support is everything. And the people who make it, whether it's methadone, abstinence, or people who have support systems in place. So to me, that's the whole key.
I just wanted to address the peer-to-peer thing, because I strongly believe peer-to-peer is fabulous. But you know what? They don't. Sorry.
You want the mic? I was saying peer-to-peer is wonderful, and I really support it. I think it's one of the best tools. But what I found is that they're not heard. You know, we know with Sean LeBlanc, and that he's been on the street, like, continuously being friends to his peers and helping them through the process and leading the way. And he wasn't being heard. He didn't have a voice in the government, or, again, I'm using the places that I know. Sean LeBlanc? Oh, I'm sorry. he's a former user, substance user. He started using substances after losing his fiance, who was pregnant, and she, I believe she committed suicide. And he couldn't get over it. And he almost, well, he nearly died several times until somebody reached out and helped him up and took a look at the story and the reasons why behind it. And from that point of recovery, he's gone on and on and on, and that's all he does is work with his peers, giving them the same hand up. But nobody was paying attention. You know, and it was like his voice didn't matter. I think it matters a lot. When I realized that his voice didn't matter, I thought, well, if his voice doesn't matter, whose voice is going to matter? And Donald and I have had this conversation on several occasions. Unfortunately, it's the parents' voice. It's the family's voice. We have to stand up and say, hey, no more. And you know, somebody else mentioned about, you know, your typical addict, you know, somebody on the street and down in Hastings and things like that. That's not true. It wasn't true in her case. It was in my daughter's case. Yes, I agree. But it can be anyone's child. Anyone's child. It's in all walks of society. And nothing is clearer than reading the stats on the fentanyl overdose deaths that have... They've tripled in Alberta. Ontario doesn't keep proper stats, so I can't give them to you, but I know from getting my reports on a weekly basis that it's probably as much, if not more. So it's the parent's voice standing up and saying, hey, my kid's addicted. I don't know what to do. Help me out here. But those services aren't yet available. The other thing that I found was there were no services available for people like myself and Petra who have lost a child to substance use. Do you know how we're treated when we say my daughter died from an opiate overdose? I didn't mention this in my talk, and I want to. My daughter died in hospital on prescribed medicines that she was overdosing on, and the doctor wasn't trained to recognize an overdose. Naloxone was sitting right beside her, and I sat there and watched
as her respiration shallowed and her heart stopped. That's the piece that I'm trying to get across. Education. Find out. Know the steps. She should never have died. I had 6 months. You saw how healthy she was from where she had started. We worked hard. She wanted to recover. And because of the lack of knowledge, a doctor allowed things to happen. I can't blame the doctor. Lack of education. I think I got off topic there.
I just want to say, I as a mother also lost a child. 5 years ago, my son had just turned 25. Accidental drug overdose. He also exasperated, and he was living basically on his own. His girlfriend left that morning, and she said he seemed to be fine in that bad cough and that. She came back, and he died. He was already gone. But now I deal with now a 20-year-old who started using drugs somewhere between 12 and 13. He also has been in the youth center. This is his second time in jail. When he has been out, to me, he hasn't had enough talk with counselors, not enough with addictions. He's been to the treatment center with the counselor over there whenever he decided it would be every 2 weeks, not every week, every second day or anything else. It was when basically he chose when he wanted to be seen. Jail, they do not force any kind of treatment. And that pisses me off because, and even the courts, I've had to go to court. Because, and my victim's impact statement, he's not allowed to come home because of the last abuse and upsetting the house, walls being punched, myself also, and the verbal and everything else. He's now not allowed to come home. And in my victim's impact statements, different times I've said to them, put my son into long-term treatment. I don't need another son to die. He needs help, and I need the help for him, but they won't force it. So where do we go, and how do we make our courts, our laws change that this system can get this in gear where these type of addicts that don't belong in jail, they belong in long-term treatment? Because I've been fighting for that one.
Myself and Donald, answer that, please. This is why we're here. This is why we're talking to you. This is why we're having you tell us your stories. These are the stories that need to go to be the voices of the UN. So thank you, and thank you for sharing. And your son will not be forgotten. He will not. We are speaking. No, it's not just our children, it's the children. Thank you for sharing.
Thank you. For being here tonight. Everything has been amazing, listening to your stories. I was unsure whether or not I would even speak. My career is in the criminal justice system. I go back and forth whether or not that's where I should be. off and on for 13 years, I've been in the criminal justice system, back and forth between youth and adults. my passion is with youth, and I do believe that, as the gentleman back there that is in recovery was talking about, it does have to start with youth. I do believe in that we do have to take a proactive approach, not a reactive approach, in order to make a difference. I have a little boy that is only 9. He hasn't had a chance that I'm aware of, to get involved in drugs yet. However, he has a very long list of mental health problems that is going to make him much more susceptible to the possibility of going into drugs. I also have a best friend who is a recovering drug addict, and I can remember in our early 20s calling her drug dealer to find out what to do because she was overdosing and not taking her to the hospital. So even though I am in the criminal justice system, I have seen and witnessed lots of situations where drugs have been involved on both sides of the fence. And I do agree that there does need to be more counselors. There needs to be more community-oriented counseling that approaches instead of criminal approaches, jail time. There needs to be more, the INSAY program that you said. I was really inspired when you talked about that, that going across Canada. I think that's a wonderful initiative. I hope to see that.
I think I should just hold on to this. There's another program that is very exciting, and it's called the Gloucester program. If you Google it, Glou, G-L-O-U-C-H-E-S-T-E-R, I believe.
Oh, Gloucester. In Ottawa, like Gloucester.
No, it's actually out of Massachusetts, but the really exciting part of that is that the Halifax Police Department are taking a very close look at it.
Okay.
And what they do is it's a diversion program. So when children or young adults, even older adults, are arrested on some type of a drug charge or picked up off the street for being drunk and disorderly or drugged and disorderly, they're diverted. It's straight to a counselor or to detox or rehab. So they've got all of the steps in place. It's not a criminal action. It's a health crisis. So it's evolving. And yes, it's slow. But the fact that Gloucester put it into practice and Halifax is already looking at it before the rest of the states is even adopting the program. Seattle has adopted it as well. It's amazing. Like that's just a snowball waiting to avalanche, and I'm so happy. I hope we all get caught up in that big snowball. Give a great big hug. There's hope. So don't give up on your practice.
No, and you know what? And for me, I go back to youth, and that's where my passion is. And my final thing that I want to say is that as moms, we have to fight. I have a 9-year-old that I have fought for since I was 6 weeks old. And if I have to fight and fight for him to keep him out of drugs, because I know that he's more vulnerable, I will do that. And 20 years ago, we wouldn't be sitting here today at all having this kind of discussion.
No, we'd be sitting here talking about birth control and how we can't let our children have that.
We wouldn't be sitting here talking about needle exchanges. We wouldn't be sitting here talking about how can we have these counseling sessions and how we can do CBT therapy and stuff like that to help people with drug addictions. We wouldn't be doing it. And I'm just so proud to be here tonight. I just want to say that, and thank you so much.
Thank you. I think we have time for one more question. Okay, great.
I'm sorry. I guess I have been so honored to be here tonight, and I've been so privileged to be able to see some of the journeys that have happened, particularly here at the Reach Center, and I really admire all the work that's getting done, both by volunteers like Rose and, Ronnie, as well as the employees of the province like Tom and Anne-Marie. And I was just at a conference, and I'm really excited about the progress that's been happening on PEI. I went to elementary school for grades 1 and 2 at the Addiction Center when it was a primary school, so there's change and there's progress, and it's possible even though we're a small and slow province sometimes. I was just at a conference in Antigonish on the weekend, and it was dealing with post-traumatic stress disorder, and they had a number of wonderful speakers. One of them was from the Nova Scotia health system, and she spoke about how so often illnesses compound on each other, and one of the ways that it happens is a mental health problems will spiral into addictions. And so we know that, and there's been so many instances here tonight, eloquently and tragically spoken about, of if only there had been help when it was just a counseling issue, or when it was just a self-esteem problem, or when it was just depression. And those are all things that happen before they try a drug. And if they felt normal and included and socially accepted before they tried the drug, then there'd be no alteration, right, of their mood or their state, or, you know, they would already be happy. So I guess what I'm wondering is, right now we're talking a lot about the reaction of it, and we're talking about how there's not enough. Everyone has articulated this. This isn't just me, but the Addiction Services Center, it's not enough, it's not enough. They're doing the best they can. Everybody who works in addictions is doing the very best they can. I have never seen anyone who's taken a lackadaisical approach to, you know, caring about the illness that is addiction once you get into it. But I do see a lot of indifference and a lot of not being able to even get into it with some places like, or not even addictions, just mental health issues before they become addiction issues, at doctor's offices, at school's guidance counselor's offices, and in all the places where youth go to share their feelings. If they get turned away there, where the hell else is there to go but to a friend's place to talk about your shit, and there's some shit there that goes down, and that's where it starts. And so, you know, like, that's how it happens, is you go to share your feelings and or whatever it is. So you just deal with it however you can, because you've done what all the posters tell you to do, and you've done what the guidance counselor tells you to do, and go tell an adult that you trust, and they turn you away. And that's something that needs to stop. And I'm wondering, I know everyone's working on addictions and everything, and I'm just wondering what... So it's really great that there's all this help happening. And I'm wondering, who do we go to ask about this? Is there a, and you guys can speak to this, and I know that there's some people from the government here and different places saying, you know, it's great, we're doing the best we can with what we've got. Is there any committee, is there any group, is there any person in a position to facilitate the government and the Reach Center and the Addiction Center and the kids in the schools and primary care physicians are where they tell you to go first? Is there anyone, is there any group that's trying to coordinate all that? Like, I know that's what we're here talking about, but I'm wondering if PEI has anything like that, because I think that's a great place to start. And I think that's what needs to happen first is, so maybe you guys can speak to that. I know you'd be the people working most closely.
I believe a lot of those things are diverse from one another, like education is not the same as health. In addictions and mental health, there's connection between the two services. They're integrating. We work with a concurrent disorder focus, so we're trying to be more mental health minded in addictions, and mental health is trying to be more addiction focused in mental health treatment. However, a lot of the things like schools and what happens in justice, they're not, I don't think there's any one other than perhaps the premier who's over all of those different things. They're kind of scattered, I think.
He's got a couple portfolios, I think. He's pretty busy. I don't think he's got time for it. Do you think? Oh, great. Okay.
Yeah. Actually, Wade, back there in the corner, and okay. Myself, we're both on the province's Mental Health and Addictions Advisory Council.
Awesome. I was hoping there'd be
something
like that.
And at that table, there are people from schools, psychiatry, addictions...
Justice.
Yeah, so we have all the pillars covered. So, and right now we're working on the long-term strategy for the province, but all those voices are at the table. Yeah, and the family voice as well, and a person in recovery.
I'm so happy to hear that.
Yeah. We got one more? Okay.
Good evening. I'm Lisa Matheson-Walters, and I work at the Bethanol Maintenance Clinic with four amazing physicians. And I do the co-occurring disorder counseling role that you're talking about. And the thing for me is, in other provinces, we've adopted a no wrong door approach. And that's what I've been advocating for in Prince Edward Island, that no matter what service you go into, that there's a continuum of service and a continuity of intake. And I think that's somewhere what we're talking today is moving in that direction.
I want to thank everyone for being here, and I especially want to thank Rose and Ronnie for initiating and for the panel here. It's been very interesting, and I give you my deepest sympathy for the loss of your loved ones. Donna, you made a comment that I think is really important, and it's about parents being advocates for their children. But what we have to do, I think, and obviously of primary interest, is the individual who has the addictive behavior, and to do what we can. And I'll be honest, when I first started down this journey, it was, why doesn't he just stop? We brought him up better than this, you know, we've given him everything, he's had a good life, so what the heck, you know. And of course, as a parent, what did we do wrong? Like, you know, I mean, my God, like, I should have seen a sign earlier, I should have intervened earlier, and whatnot, you know. So the person with the addictive behavior is most important. But we have a long ways to go. We've come a long ways, but we have a long ways to go in educating the parents. Because the parents, there's an awful stigma attached to the person with the addictive behavior. I agree with that. But as parents, too, there's a terrible stigma attached. And we're so scared for our children. And we're scared, if we speak to the wrong person, it's going to have long-term effects on their lives. And so we're trying to, in secret, you know, find the help. We don't know who to go to. You know, I remember when we started down our journey, I mean, I was calling the states, like, oh, I'll remortgage the house. I don't care what I have to do. I got to find somewhere to get them into. I phoned the province, and that didn't help me very much. I didn't know who to go to because, I mean, like, it was just not something I'd ever dealt with before. And, I mean, I will be honest, even it took me 3 years into this nightmare before I'd finally even seek help for myself, right? And because I was scared in a small community like Charlottetown, I didn't want to go to the meeting. Because if I go to the meeting, there's going to be somebody there that sees me. Then they're going to know. And then they're going to tell people about it, you know. And my family, I hid it from my family. And when I look back, I know I made some poor choices that probably was an enabler, right? But I was trying, in my mind, I was trying to protect. You know, he was a young boy. And it can happen to anyone's child. And I think that's really an important message. And unless it's happening to your child, though, people don't want to hear about it because it's not a sexy problem. They don't want to hear about it. It's like I said, you know, kids in daycare. You're concerned about the cost of daycare when your child's in daycare. When your child starts school and you no longer pay for daycare, you don't really give a damn. You're concerned about the cost of university and the cost of books when your kid's in university. When your kid's out of university, you don't really give a damn anymore. And it's the same, I find, with addiction. Like, and people don't want to hear about it because it's almost like they're scared it's going to rub off. She's my sister, I can do that. So I really think that's an important piece to it as well, is to find ways to educate the parents early so we know what to look for and so we know who to go to. So we know what we can do to help and to advocate. Because I'll be honest, I didn't even know how to advocate for my son. I knew how to, you know, when it came to the sports, I knew about things like that. When maybe it came to the education system. But when it came to advocating for him to get the help that he needed, I didn't know who to go to. And there's such a shame attached to it. And you love your child so much that you're trying to protect them. And you're maybe doing more harm than good. But it's out of desperation.
Yeah, everything you said, that's true. Yeah.
that's really one of the key issues that to help him, and that is a call also to those who develop addiction services. Keep the family in mind, because we say it takes a village to raise a child. It especially takes a village when that child is struggling, and we have to give that village information. But one thing we also say at Moms Do is that nothing is learned in silence. I've heard Donna say that many times. Nothing is learned in silence. That's why we are speaking here. That's why you're speaking. And that's why we also need to take this out of the criminal justice issue, because if seeking help for your kid means risking getting him thrown in jail, that is what keeps things under the rug, and that's, as a gentleman pointed out, then problems escalate to a point where it becomes far, far more difficult. If we would have had help for Danny early on with his mental health issues, with his anxiety, early on in the addiction, it would have been much, much easier. Once they become an injection drug user, the road to recovery, as you can probably attest, gets a lot more difficult. So speak up, parents. You know, speak up for your children. And the more parents speak up, after we spoke out about Danny, you could not believe the emails and messages we got from people we know, colleagues of my husband's at the University of Alberta, successful doctors, professors, who said, oh, I've never mentioned it to you. My daughter is in recovery on the West Coast in a treatment program. I never mentioned it to you. My son is struggling with addictions. So once you start speaking up, there will be some that condemn you, but the far majority of people will thank you for speaking up, and they will also share with you that they have similar struggles. So that's where we need to start, to break the silence, you know, as parents.
And as Moms Do, because we all found it very difficult to navigate the system, we are putting together a resource booklet that we hope everybody will contribute to. Just anything you can think of that would be help, either for a family, parents, or the substance user themselves, that can be used as a resource. And we'll do all of the dissemination and sift through it, you know, who should go where and where it should be placed in this guide. But we need a guide.
We're running a little bit over time, so I don't want to keep anybody who has to leave, but I'm going to give each panelist maybe a minute or two just to make some closing statements, and I'll do a little closing as well. It's been a great discussion. I could stay here all night. But if anyone does have to leave, like, don't feel rude if you have to get up and leave while people are speaking. I know everyone is busy. So if you guys want to take just a couple of minutes, and some closing statements, that'd be great.
I'm just totally, totally amazed at the energy in this room and the stories and the connectivity. And I really appreciate the comment about trauma from the back there, and the comment about peers over here. This is about harm reduction, and I think, to me, harm reduction is overarching over everything, because we're trying to reduce harm. The goal of policing should be to reduce harm. The goal of therapy should be to reduce harm. The goal of communities should be to reduce harm. So harm reduction is about, a Dutch guy said, I asked him, what do you do in Holland? It's this harm reduction stuff. And he said, you know, harm reduction, it's about building relationships and deepening those relationships. And that's really all it is. I mean, yes, there are syringes involved and all that stuff, but the real product of that syringe transition is you get to know each other, and those statements that were made about the syringe exchange were powerful statements of acceptance and belonging. And belonging and acceptance are two huge things. So the other thing I want to say is that this is a really literate group, and people, we haven't been allowed to talk about drugs and drug policy for 100 years, and we're just crawling out from underneath the rocks, and we're having these conversations. And so it's a literacy issue, and your community community has to become literate too. And so, you know, this room full of people could transform a community or a city or an island maybe. It's a real honor and pleasure to have been part of this amazing session.
Like I said to begin with, I always have a lot to say. And you all know that now. My daughter sits on my shoulder and she guides me. And she said, "Good job, Mom. And thank you all for being here."
To those of you whose children are struggling with addictions, I say you're really lucky. You're really lucky. You have your children and you walk with them in their struggles. So keep them safe. They will smarten up. They will see the light. They will get help. And also there are ways, there are different ways we can live, like you described with your son. He's in treatment, he has a room, he has quality of life. Quality of life, what we define as quality of life, vastly differs. And so love those children, walk with them, walk in their shoes and stand by them and consider yourself so lucky.
I'll just simply say, as stated earlier, why does needle exchange work? It's because it's non-judgmental. We try to involve the client. We try to get, how they're feeling, their attitudes, what we can do to help them. And I think it's as basic as that.
Harm reduction saves lives. Thank you all for coming this evening.
All right. Well, I wanted to thank everybody for coming, and I certainly wanted to say thank you to all of our panelists. You were amazing, and we really appreciate having you here to share your knowledge and experience with us. I wanted to thank the Canadian Drug Policy Coalition for sponsoring this event and bringing in the moms for Moms Do. It certainly would not have happened without their support. And just to make note that in the spring we're going to have another big session as well. So watch for the details. And I'd also like to thank the Reach Center for providing the space. They're really good to me anytime, and Ronnie, anytime we want to do an event or anything like that, they give us the space, which is wonderful because we're a no-budget little organization here, so it's great. And Smart Recovery is also a sponsor. We had some of our facilitators here tonight volunteering and helping, so thank you. And Moms DU and Health PEI for sending some of their staff our way with their valuable information and what they do. There's a business across the street called EMC, and I want to thank them for allowing us to use their parking lot tonight so it's safe as possible for people to park. The town of Stratford provided us with some chairs, UPEI with the podium, and all of our volunteers and all of you for coming tonight. We really appreciate it. As a family who's struggled with addiction, you know, you do early on in the journey, you certainly do feel alone, you feel stigmatized, frustrated, scared to death. You know, you're facing something that's probably more painful than anything you're ever going to face except losing a child, and you're facing it in a broken system and all that, but it has gotten better, and we're very fortunate in our family to have recovery, so that is a gift. It's a gift that brings me to tears sometimes just out of the blue for no reason, because I know how lucky we are to have that. So yes, and Barb traveled all the way here from Nova Scotia, so I wanted to give a special mention to her. And to Paul Weatherby back there in the audio, I really appreciate it. And Pat as well. Well, thanks to PAC taping, we're all going to be able to watch it again sometime if we want to, so that's really nice. And of course, to Ronnie, you know, we're like two moms on a mission, we call ourselves. So we're always up to something, and it's great to have your support. So thank you, everybody, and safe travels home tonight.